We talk about what is SAS. We talk about the what is it? About the how to install SAS and the setup that we did yesterday. The first step for the data reduction, the first command that you have to run in order to get your spectral images and light curves. Then we talk a little bit about the GUI that we have in SAS and the command line commands. And also we talk about the pipeline products, the scientific products that we generate automatically, through the pipeline, and how to get the data from the archive. And finally, we will talk about a couple of services that you can use in order to use SAS if you don't have the software installed. No, this RISA and the Data Lab initiative that I will mention at the end. Okay, so SAS. SAS is a suite of tasks mainly developed in C++ and Fortran 90, but we also have Perl. And it has their own wrapper of MetaTask to execute a set of low-level tasks to generate the product you would like to have. I mean, we use third-party libraries as you saw yesterday. We have Cepheid.io, Grace for the 2D plotting, DS9, Heasoft. Although the software is easy to install, I mean, the dependencies with other libraries make it more difficult to use. It was developed, by a lot of programmers, more than 30 people distributed around Europe and the US. And we also have this pipeline processing system that generate the scientific product with some default parameters that we'll mention later. And we are also now, since the last SAS release, we have included Python in the distribution, so you can use it, to develop your own scripts. So we are currently using SAS 20, that's the one that you installed yesterday, that it was released in November 2021. And in a couple of months, we will release SAS 21 with new features that I mentioned later. So the flavors where we distribute SAS, as you saw yesterday, we have some CentOS, Ubuntu, and Red Hat versions. We also distribute binaries for macOS, Big Sur, and Monterey. We also distribute, from the web page, a virtual machine, a Linux virtual machine that you can install on your computer using VMware or VirtualBox. So in case you have Windows, you can use it. And since SAS 20, we are also distributing a Docker version of SAS with the binaries installed there. You can use it. You can also try with different operating system, but maybe you have some troubles with libraries. So the goal is to make it, the installation simple, but sometimes it's not possible. And as you saw yesterday, you have to install some other libraries. Note for the coming future, as you know, Mac, has moved from Intel to ARM processors. So which means that we have to build a native SAS distribution for M1 processor that we still don't have. But don't worry, because in the Mac, you have a Rosetta application that emulates this Intel terminal, so you can execute the Intel software without problems. So in order to install SAS that we did yesterday, and I think you all did it, so no problem. You download the Tarjeta file, you run the install bus script, and you will need, you will install this XMEM SAS 2021-11-30, which is the distribution, the SAS 20 distribution. We are not distributing the source code, but we are trying to distribute it along the year. So as soon as the source code is distributed, you may try to build SAS on your own computer and with your own operating system. Then, as you saw yesterday, there is a script which is called setSAS that set up the environmental variables for you. So you don't have to do anything. You just only have to locate this setSAS script. And if you are using the bus shell, you know that you can execute it with the dot. And if it is a C shell, you have to use it with the source command. We have talked, Mateo and Carlos, they have talked a lot about X-rays. And I will just mention that, X-ray detector, photon countings, and there are some properties or characteristics that define the events, no? Which is the position in the detector, the energy, the arrival time, and the shape of the event that you will see later, the shape of the event in the detector I mean, it's you, maybe you need to, I mean, to know that they have several, they can have several shapes in order to filter those shapes that are interesting for you. The software, I mean, does everything for you. So you only need to know that the shape of the pattern in the CCD is important. So this is an event file. I don't know if you are get used to the fits file, but this is a fits file, and this is the content of the of a typical event list. That is one of the products that that you will get with SAS. You will have a column with the time. This is a time in UTC, UTC with all the correction applied, X and Y, which is the position on the detector, the physical coordinate, the PHA and the PA energy in electron volts. Patterns that I mentioned and the CCD number where the photon was detected. Okay. Please ask me a question. I mean, if it is, I mean, if I'm going too quick. So now, I mean, what are the three main products that you will have with any basically X-ray detector? The spectrum, the image, and the time series. So we can think about these three products as a kind of projections. For example, if you collapse time and space, you will have the spectrum, which is a counts per energy beam. If you collapse the time and the energy, then you have an image, a 2D image, no? Or if you collapse the space, time, and the energy, you will have a time series, a light curve. So those are the three main products that you get with any X-ray detector. And those three products are properties, intrinsic properties of the physical, of the celestial source that you are observing. So what is the process, I mean, in order to achieve the final scientific products? As I mean, this is a schema of all the process in the, you know, the satellite is observing a source, it's taking the data. As Carlos mentioned, XMM is a 24/7 satellite, so it has to have coverage with antennas always. The data received in the ground station, from the ground station, it goes to the operational center. And there we construct this ODF, but the ODF is observable file. I mean, the constituents of all your data for this observation. Together with this data, we have to add the time calibration and the attitude calibration. Those are two files that came later in the process, but are included in this ODF. So at the end, together with the time calibration, the ODF and the attitude, you have your constituent that you need to analyze the data. Then we enter into the data reduction, the ODF reduction, where we will need the calibration that Mateo mentioned before, the optic calibration, the detector calibration. So with those two things, we have the scientific product, the calibrated event list that you will need to use in order to generate your science that they, later on you will have to apply with the exposure map, the point spread fraction, the effective area, the redistribution, all the things that Mateo mentioned. And then you will be able to do your science, as Mateo mentioned. So those are all the steps that we will follow during these days. How this transformation from the ODF, from the raw data, to the calibrated event list, I mean, what is the difference between one and the other? So at the beginning, we only have frames, raw X, raw Y, I mean, position detector, and the energy channel, as Mateo mentioned. And at the end of the process, at the end of the execution of the SAS task, we'll have time in UTC, X and Y in celestial coordinates, M lambda and cross dispersion in the case of RDS, or energy in the case of the EPIC cameras. And with this calibrated event file, you will be able to filter the data and get your products, filtering your data that we'll see later. So this is, for example, an example of an image without any calibration on it. You see all the CCDs with the different quadrant with different colors. And once we run all the tasks with all the calibration, you will get something like that with where you see the sources and the background. In SAS, we have two main brands, which are the EPIC branch and the RGS branch. Okay, how to analyze the EPIC PN and EPIC MOS cameras, or how to process the RGS camera. We also have OM. OM has a different branch that we will also see during these 2 weeks. In the case of the EPIC, we go to, I mean, there are two tags, EPIPROC and EMPROC, which you will see later. With those two tags, we'll get the event list. And from this event list, after the filtering, you will get the spectra, the time series, the images, and the source detection. And then, as Matteo mentioned, then you publish your paper and you get the glory. In the case of the RGS, it's more or less similar. There is a task which is called RGS Proc that it does everything for you. And at the end of this task, we have the event list, the spectra, and the source list. You will see that, as Matteo mentioned, we also have RGS Fluxer, so we also have the flux spectra. And with this event list, we also have time series and images. So the ODF, the constituent that I mentioned before, is a set of files where we have all the information about the CCDs, the science, auxiliary and housekeeping data, spacecraft information that is needed for the task, and the spacecraft attitude and the time correlation that I mentioned. We also have a summary file, this ODF summary file, which is an ASCII file with information about all the constituents in the ODF. So those in black are stored in FIT format, but in binary. And I say the ODF summary file is in ASCII. We will also see later. So now in detail, what the procs, the AP proc or EM proc does. It's a meta task, which means that it runs a lot of tasks inside and generate the calibrating event list with some filtering. And it also, those tasks are also in charge of the generation of the GTIs, the good time intervals. So you will see there are some periods during the observation where, for whatever reason, the quality of the data is not correct. So the software is in charge of removing those periods, and we will also have the good time intervals, okay? So it's the GTIs you will see during these 2 weeks a lot. And once we have the event list, there is another task that I will mention also later, that is XMEM Select, which is a GUI task that will allow you to play a little bit with the image, with the filtering, with the cuts that you can do in energy, and also you can select some different periods of time in order to create your spectra or images. XMEM Select is a really very important task, so you will use it a lot. In a nutshell, no, what the EpiProc does, I mean, as I said, it's a meta task and it runs several what we call low level tasks. So tasks that deal with the raw data and modify those files. We'll go through the main ones. So the first one is IP frames basically convert from times on board of the satellite, so from clicks to UTC times, and also convert the frames into UTC. The batpix and batpix find, it try to detect anomalies on your detector and remove those batpix column and pixel from your data. IP events is in charge of the conversion of the PHA into PI channels, so to get electron balls. The ATCAL is the one in charge of the attitude correction, so deal with the row X and row Y until you get the celestial coordinates. And finally, EBLISCOM combine all these files for all of the CCDs and generate just only one file for all of the CCDs. So, and this, I mean, EpiProc does everything for you. So at the end of this process, we have a FITS file with basically these 14 columns. The time, which is when the photon arrived, rho X and rho Y, where the photon hit the CCD in CCD coordinates, X and Y, which is the detector ectodetector ward in detector coordinates, and also X and Y in celestial coordinates. PHA and PA and PY, I mean the energy, flag, I mean the detector, I mean where the detector hit the CCD and what is the how good is this event? I mean, if it hit on the detector where we have some gaps or problems, and the pattern that I mentioned before, and then the CCD number. So those are the 14 columns that you will use for filtering your data. As we mentioned, the bad pixels, we may have two types of bad pixels, hot and bad. I mean, the hot, I mean, they are bright pixels with a lot of counter for whatever reason, the behavior is not good. And the software, I mean, remove those pixels, or bad, which is basically an empty, a dead pixel, which also, I mean, the software, I mean, take care of it. The filtering, I mean, there is some filtering during the procs, during the AP proc and AM proc process that try to identify some bad periods in the during the observation. And there is a parameter which is flag filtering events that you can enable or disable in order to get or remove directly from the event list those periods. At the end of the process, we will generate what is written at the bottom, an imaging or a timing event file with the information of the observation, together with some bad pixel tables that are also included in the main file. So as soon as we reach the end of the procs, we are in a situation where we can start, for example, extracting a spectra. As I mentioned, the XMM select is the tool to use in order to get the spectra light curve images. I mean, the way to execute the command is as simple as that. You type XMM select table and the event file, which is the output of epiproc or emproc. We have this thread on the web page that we will follow these days in order to, for example, filter for flaring particle background or to get the recipe of the PN spectral extraction that we will also see later. So XMM select is, I mean, the GUI is like this. You can select with the buttons X and Y. You can create an image. Once you have the image, you can create, I mean, with DS9, you can create a region with your source and the background. There are some ways to optimize those regions, you know, to get the good signal to noise. And at the bottom of the XMM GUI, you have this OGIP spectral product button, for example, that if you click it, you get the spectra together with the response matrix and the RMF, as Mateo mentioned. We will see later the files. We can do the same for light curve, which on this button here at the bottom, OGIP red light curve, so you can get spectra and light curve. In the case of RGS proc, I mean, the other branch, we know, I mean, as I said, I mean, we have this RGS proc tool that it creates the event list, the spectra, response matrix, and the source list, and also the flags spectra, what Mateo mentioned. This approximation of the combination of the response matrix and the spectra to get the physical units. It's a product of this task. RGS proc is a very complex task. We'll see now more than 80 parameter switches, but normally the default default parameters are good enough in order to process the data. It is important that for the RGS proc, we will have to enter the coordinate of the source, as we see later. And then with the event file, you can also use XMM select in case you would like to filter some events from the event list. So why in the case of RGS introduce the coordinate is important? Because as you know, and as Carlos mentioned, in RGS we have this the detector where the cross dispersion and the source, I mean, will lie, and the cross dispersion is important. I mean, the pointing of the satellite and the pointing of the source, I mean, the relation of those two quantities is important because you have to tell the processing software what is this difference between the pointing and where the source is in order to get the source and the background region in the right place. Okay, so you need to calculate this fee distance in order to get the right, I mean, the source, I mean, the source region, the background region in the right place. Okay, so if you, I mean, it's good to enter the coordinates of the source when you run RDS proc. So all the tasks all the low level tasks that RDS proc run, they are, I mean, a lot of them. So this first, I mean, set of tasks has to do with sort in an independent way. So they're more or less calibration. We have ATTHK gen for the attitude generation, add filter, it creates some filtering with respect to the housekeeping data, HK GTI gen, also another set of GTIs, RGS offset cal, it get the diagnostic data from RGS and compute it put in the proc, RGS sources to create the list of sources in the field of view, RGS frame, as in EP frames, it converts the frames and the OBT course and OBT time, or the time at the instrument in UTC time. RGS energy, get the compute the PI in electron volts, RGS bad peaks and RGS batteries fine to find, I mean, where the bad pixel and bad colors are, and the RGS events that combine and create the energy, the shape, and the M lambda calculations. Then there is an event list comp, so all the CCDs are combined in a single event file, and then we have the second step where the position of the source is important. We have the RGS angle, RGS filter, filtering some of the bad periods in the observation, RGS regions to compute the background in RGS. We compute the spectrum in the proc. So we have to, we also run RGS spectrum that create the spectrum out of the sur region and the background region that you can also parameterize. In RGS, there is an RGS background model. That is what Mateo was mentioned. There's a possibility to model the background for RGS and use it instead of the background from the observation. And then finally, the generation of the response matrix, RGS RMFGN, and the RGS flux, which is the flux, the task to create the flux spectrum, which is a spectrum in physical units. So all these tasks are executed by RGS proc. So basically, but you don't have to take care of them. RGS proc, I mean, take care of everything. So the products of the RGS proc, as Carlos mentioned yesterday, we have this dispersion channel, the banana plot, I mean, with the first order and the second order. Also, you can plot to create a PDF or a GIF file of the sur region, as you in the cross dispersion, as you see in this at the top of this image, or the regions in energy space that are created by the RGS proc automatically, and then the spectra, the effective area, and XML select, which is the tool to play with it. The output of RGS, I mean, there's a lot of files. It's not the same as the proc, where we only have the event file and the bad pixels. But in RGS, we have the event file, which is the first one. Then the sur list, which is the file containing the position of the sources for this observation. Then the background spectrum at the sur spectrum, first order and second order. You have an identifier, with one or two, in the observation, saying that it's first order, second order. The sur plus background spectra, the response matrix, this RSP mat, first order, second order. By default, in RGS proc, you always generate first order and second order. If the sur is very, very bright, you can also generate third order, fourth order, but it's not common. Then the time series that are also generated automatically by RGS proc with this sur and background identifier, first order and second order. And then there are some of the files, are not generated automatically by RGS proc, but you will get it in the pipeline products. Oops. Which are these cross dispersion images, dispersion energy image, exposure map, which is also generated by RGS proc, and the background time series and the PDF files. And I think that's all. And the flux, the RGS flux set, the flux spectra that is generated both for RGS proc and the pipeline. So those are all the files generated by RGS proc. So now what do we have to do? To really start running all these tasks. As you saw, the ODF that you will download today, you will use it today. Contains a set of files, and the very first thing that you have to do is run ODF ingest that it creates and it says an advanced summary file. So it's an ASCII file with some more information about the observation that we are dealing with. You run before running ODF ingest, you have to tell the software, you have to tell SAS where the ODF is, and this is controlled by the SAS ODF environmental variable. you set the SAS ODF environmental variable pointing to the place where you have the ODF, and then you run the command ODF ingest and assume .sas file is created, and this is needed for the rest of the processing. The sum SAS file is also an ASCII file that contains more information about each of the instrument and each of the exposure on the instrument. This is used by the SAS, but it's not, I mean, you can have a look, but it's not needed. And then once you have run ODF ingest, you have to set again the SAS ODF environmental variable, but now pointing to the sum SAS file. And this is needed for the rest of the SAS task. I will recommend you, I mean, whenever you have to set one of these environmental variables, to do it with the absolute path. Because if you enter the absolute path, doesn't matter if you change directory or you move to another place, that the software always knows where the file is. So then once you have run the ODF ingest and you have the sum SAS file, then the next step you will always have to do is to create the calibrate, the CCF file, which is a file that contains the list of all the calibration file that you will use during the processing, okay? And this is done with a task which is called thiefbuild. To do this, before running this task, you have to tell the software where the CCF files are located with this SAS underscore CCF path variable. You set the environmental variable and then you run the task, and then you generate a fit file with the information of all the calibration file and the version of those files that you will use during the processing. Once you run the task, you have to set up the SAS CCF environmental variable, but this time pointing to the CCF.c file. Okay, again, I mean, if you enter the absolute path, then, I mean, it doesn't matter if you change directory or move to any other place, that everything is okay. So, and then a very useful task that you can have a look. I mean, whenever you finish with the ODF ingest and the SIF build task is ODF browser, which is a GUI that tells you some information about the content of your observation. For example, in this example, you have where the ODF is located, when the observation was taken, the start time and the stop time, the observation ID, proposal ID, so, and for each of the instrument, when the instrument was active, and the exposure identifier for each of the exposures. So in an observation, you may have only one exposure, or you may have more than one exposure. And this is controlled by this identifier. And if you click on the, on one of the exposure identifier, you will get also the mode of the instrument. As you can see here, if it is imaging or if it is in timing. Okay, so have a look to ODF browser. I mean, it's quite useful at the beginning. And later when you analyze 200 observations, then you don't pay attention. So the thief build, something that you have to bear in mind. I mean, in the calibration file, we have three values, the val date, eval date, and date that controls what is the best calibration file you can use for your observation. So in principle, I mean, thiefbuild does everything automatically for you because you always have to use the latest calibration, okay? So, but it's good to know that these three values are inside of each of the calibration file. So for example, it may happen as in the example, I mean, on the top of this slide, that you, at a given time T, you may have one calibration file with two versions, one and two, and a second calibration file with six versions, one, two, three, five, and six. But the validity period for those second calibration file, it may happen that the version two and version five correspond to your time, and the software will always select the version five because it's the latest one. Okay, so that's how the thief build and the calibration file works in XML. And it is done automatically. So The CCF, I mean, as we saw yesterday, you have to download the CCF from the from our repository, from the web page. And in, I mean, we have it here, so in case you don't have it, we can pass it to you. And it's always good to have a look to the content of the CCF, because from time to time we update the calibration and you will have to download the new calibration files. Sometimes even the software, if for whatever reason the calibration is mandatory, it's a mandatory calibration for the software, you may have to update the calibration file because the software cannot work with the old CCF file. So it's something you have to check. Then, now we know that we have the procs, we have the ODF hinges, we have the thief bill, and now we can really start working. It depends if you are using CCL or BAS. We have the scripts for both cells. So you have to set SAS, set SAS ODF, the CCF path, you run a thief build, you run ODF, and you have the system ready to run the procs, okay? This is an example for the CCL, and this is an example for a BAS, although it's a SAS script, but it's exactly the same. So, okay, so now, where you can find the information about SAS and the documentation and everything. So in the ESA webpage, you have the XMN Newton data analysis link, where you have information about the news, how to run SAS, how to download, everything. And within the how to use SAS, we have the threads that we see now. We have the user guide. We have the watchout page that is very, from time to time, whenever you have a problem, you have to go to this watchout page because maybe it's a problem that we identify and we reported how to solve it. The SAS cookbook, which say a guide, to analyze SAS data written by Goddard. So the ESAS cookbook, ESAS is a part of SAS that allows you to analyze extended sources. In the next SAS release, ESAS has been completely refactored, and there's going to be a complete new set of ESAS tasks in SAS. And then you also have the type by task information, documentation in this link. So the threads. You can find it in the how to use SAS link. And since a couple of years, we have started the migration of these threads into Jupyter Notebook threads. So we only have these three Jupyter Notebook threads, the startup, the how to reprocess the ODF for Epic cameras, and how to filter the Epic event list for particle background. So have a look. If you know how to use the Jupyter Notebook, it's nice. I will see now. And then the rest of the threads, they are not in Jupyter Notebook, and they are just plain HTML5 that step by step will allow you to execute the SAS task needed for the thread. The Jupyter Notebook. If you use the Jupyter Notebook, it's very useful because you have the thread, in a kind of interactive way. You can go, one by one, executing the Python command directly from the browser. So it's very useful. And this is linked with the Data Labs initiative that I will mention at the end. And in the case of the threads that are not in Jupyter Notebook, it's an HTML page, so you have to copy and paste the command. If you want to know how to use it, but nevertheless, it's a very detailed, thread, so you will not have any trouble to follow. So and you can have plots and images, examples all over the threads. So now the GUIs. In SAS we have, you have a GUI version for each of the tasks, so you can. You can use the GUI or the command line that we'll see later. Maybe at the beginning, it's better if you use the GUI because you see all the parameters. In the parameters, you will see that some of the parameters are mandatory, some are not mandatory. So it's always good to have a look to the GUI because it's more user-friendly. In the case of this main GUI, which is the SAS GUI, you can run all of the rest of the SAS tasks. You can define the settings, and you can select the task and execute it from this command. And you have the log, I mean, in the same SAS GUI. I mean, have a look. I mean, it's useful. But as I mentioned, I mean, you always have the possibility to run the task, whatever task, from the command line. In order to get the GUI of each of the tasks, there is an option which is minus D, the name of the task minus D, and you get the GUI. And as I said, some of the parameters may be mandatory, some other optional. And at the end of the, for example, in this case of EDT chain, which is the task to create the sure detection, at the end of the execution, you have a sure list with all the information about this task. Or for example, the sure display, minus D, and if you have run the detect chain, you will have the detection, all detection from the previous tasks plotted in a through DS9. So XML select is always a GUI. I mean, with XML select, you cannot do it, I mean, in command line, because it's an interactive task. Have a look to the GUI, have a look to the command line option. And the command line, obviously, at the end is better because it will allow you to create your own scripts. I mean, to repeat, I mean, the process that you are doing. And now with the Python that we include in SAS 20 and we will improve in SAS 21, you will also have the possibility to import some kind of Python libraries that will also allow you to create your Python script to use the SAS task in a more friendly way. So, I mean, it's nice. And now that everybody is using Python all over the world, so it's good. The pipeline products. So the pipeline products is a software that basically runs all the SAS tasks with some default parameter plus some other software, I mean, inside the pipeline directly. So the goal is to generate in an automatic way all the scientific products. So then, you may wonder if it is better to use the pipeline product or it is better to run EPPROC, EMPROC, RGSPROC, I mean, on my own. I mean, it depends. I mean, if you run your own task, you will be sure that you're using the latest version of the software, the calibration, while in the pipeline products, sometimes, because they go release by release with some cadence, and maybe they are using an old calibration, an old version of the software, and it is better to use the latest one. The latest, I mean, BAL reprocessing, I mean, the last time that the XMM reprocessed all the observation from the beginning of the mission till 2019, it was 2019. We reprocessed all the observation, and out of this all BAL reprocessing, the 4XMM DR9 catalog was released, which is the largest X-ray sort catalog. I will talk, I mean, about the catalog later. The next one, poof, I mean, we still don't know where we'll have the next BAL reprocessing, probably in a couple of years. Now the archive, how to deal with the data from the archive in XMM. We have the XSA, which is the XMM archive, that contains all of the ODF, all of the pipeline products, public products. I mean, the SLU, I didn't mention the SLU ODFs. In XMM, apart from the ODF, which are the observations, the satellite, while it is SLU into the next target, it also, I mean, observes. I mean, have the EPIC cameras open. And those observation are called SLU SDF, no, SLU observations that are also processed and are also ingested in the archive. So right now we have the 4XMM DR12 with more than 900,000 sources detections and more than 600 sources unique sources. We also have an OM catalog and the SLU catalog. So this is, for example, the how the SLU catalog looks like with all the trails, with all the SLU from XMEM. And you also have the possibility to use, for example, other tools as TopCat to deal with your data. And I will mention tomorrow a little bit about ISASKY, no? Which is a is this viewer of all the archives on ISA, I mean, from the web browser. I mean, it is very nice. I mean, you haven't seen it, have a look. More, I mean, details about the XMM archive. I mean, the interface is very simple. You go to the XMM webpage, that we have a link to the archive, and then you can search by target name, or you can search by ops ID. You can select the catalog you want to use, everything. And when you are happy with your search, you get this GUI or this output, and with all the observation of the target that you have selected. With access to the Epic images, RDS image, all the pipeline products, a link to the ISASKY, which is the fifth column there. You see there? There's a link to the ISASKY and information about the search. Oops. There is a button in the archive, this RGS spectra, that if you click an observation on the left and you click on the RGS, then you have the possibility to have a look to the RGS spectra in a very interactive way. You can play with the binning a little bit, and you can even combine several observation, RGS observation, and you get the RGS flux spectra. This is the flux spectra that Mateo mentioned before. And then if you click on the Epic image, you get this postcard view with some information with the three cameras combined, PN, MOS1, and MOS2. And I will mention later, you have this reprocess button that I will talk about it now, which is this RISA. So there is also a possibility to create, I mean, to reprocess, I mean, observation without having the software installed on your computer. So through the archive, as you see here, if you select an observation and you click on the reprocess button, which is this yellow button on the top, you can select what are the instruments that you want to reprocess, PM, MOS1, MOS2, RGS1, RGS2, and you click on submit, and the reprocess is done in ISAC, in a grid environment, and you get an email when the process has finished with a link to your data. So you can download your data and you can get the files. Apart from the reprocessing, if you click on the exposure, you have the possibility to create, I mean, you have this interactive analysis button. And with this interactive analysis button, you have the possibility to create an spectra, light curve, image, or time series. You have a basic filtering capabilities. You can select the flag, you can select the pattern, and the PI energy. And then you select your sub-region, through this GS9 application, you select the source, you select the background, import those two regions to the RISA section, and you click on submit, you send the request, and some minutes later you get an email with the data. In order to use this RISA functionality, you have to log in into the archive. As you know, I mean, you can use the archive without any login. But if you want to use it, these other capabilities, you can ask for an account for free, you get the account, and then you can process the data. It's very useful. If you want a quick spectra or a quick image. Then also from the archive, you have access to all the sources in the observation, okay? If you click on any observation, you get this tab with the Epic PPS source, and you have all the sources detected on the observation with all the information, a snapshot, spectra, everything. So I mean, explore the archive. And also you have a tab with the results from the 4XMM catalog with all the information about them, about the issues. So it's plenty of observation there, my information there. And then the how to, I mean, find all the files and know what are you dealing with. I mean, out of the, at the end of all the SAS process, I mean, you have plenty of files. I mean, and if you have a look to the pipeline, there are thousands of files that you have to go through and know what does it mean, which of them and what the meaning of all of them. For the EPIC, we have the M or P event list, depending if it is MOS or PN. If you run the proc, you have imaging or timing events, .ds. In the pipeline, you have the image for each of the bands. In the pipeline, you automatically process the data for different energy bands, and you have all these files there. For RGS, you also have the RGS1, RGS2, the event file, the SUR list, and the SUR spectrum, backend spectrum, and the response matrix. And ON, exactly the same. So plenty of files. There is a PPS index summary. You know, if you download the pipeline products with a summary of all this information, then you can have a look. This is the index file. You have an information of the observation, what is inside, all the sources, and the images. The documentation that I mentioned before in the SAS in the ESA webpage, have a look. Go, I mean, to the OSAS online documentation, the watch out, and you will see there all the information. So this is a kind of checklist, I mean, for you to have a look to see that if you are ready to use SAS and to process the data. You verify that you have to verify the PPS, I mean the quality, check that the report. Compare, check the calibration file, and if you have SAS installed, you can play with the data. RISA that I mentioned before, okay, is a web interface that is available through the archive and allows you to use, I mean, to create spectra, images, and light curve from the archive without having to download the data. It's very useful. I mean, have a look. You don't need to install anything. That's the main point. The architecture is very simple, and what we did a couple of years ago is that we migrate this technology to Amazon. So in case we have to process the data outside the ISAC, let's put it in this way. And thanks to this pilot that we did a couple of years ago, we were able to move to Data Labs, which is this initiative that I will mention now, it's good. Data Labs. So it's a infrastructure that you can access, I mean, through ISA. We'll try to do an exercise next week in the hands-on sessions. And you have in this data lab, you have plenty of labs, let's put it this way. In XMM, we have those two labs, but there are also Gaia, Hercel, I mean, many other ISA mission has the labs within these data labs infrastructure. So in the case of SAS, we have those two, and the one, I mean, and we have access, we have automatically access to the CCF. So we have the CCF and the ODF within this data lab environment. It's not yet operational. We are testing it, but it will be soon operational. And basically what we have in this data lab is basically the thread that I mentioned before that we have in Jupyter notebook. So the only difference is that with this data lab, you don't have to install Jupyter notebook on your laptop, so you can use it through the data lab infrastructure. And then you can go one by one executing the step, and nothing, you have nothing in your computer, everything is executed remotely, and you have the computing power, I mean, by ISA, and then you have the image and you have everything without having anything installed in your computer. The only, I mean, we are working right now on trying to apply some interactivity to this Jupyter notebook in order to select the region, the background, basic filtering, I mean, for the user to really, I mean, work with the data. And that's all. Let's go. I know it's, I mean, too many things, too many details. I think during the next couple of days and next week, you will, you can come and ask me. So,
I wanted to ask, what are the differences between the product and the chain pipelines?
I forgot to mention the chain. is this guy no different at all. So the chains were developed by the instrument teams in order to be able to react, I mean, at the beginning of the mission, to react to quick, I mean, changes in the data processing. Because, you know, the procs are binaries. So if you want to change anything there, you have to recompile the code and produce a new delivery, while the chains is a pair script that you can change on the fly. So there is no difference. I mean, in terms of the output, it's exactly the same. So we run the same task with the same default parameter, in the same order. So.
And you mentioned an RGS
block
to the rest of the
modeling
background. Is there something like this in the
RGS? No, I mean it's only for RGS. And in the web page there is because there are some work, I mean, regarding the background modeling, and if I remember correctly, there is a place for to have a look to the epic background. I will check it later. But there is nothing, no task.
And you mentioned the efforts for to allow you to see the pattern to run the script and all that. There are efforts on the same for to you.
No more programming language, please. C++, Fortran, Perl, Python, and Julia. And come to me, I mean, ask me, because I'm pretty sure, I mean, it was too much. And you have many, many, many doubts, so I will help you during these days.
They are interested in me asking questions. I will ask them.
Good.
Okay, that's fine.
Sorry for the